close friends that constantly would knock on our door and would talk to them about the Lord. My parents were devout Catholics. I remember going to Catholic church on Sundays in Brooklyn, and that was the routine. Just, you know, Sunday was church. Monday, Tuesday, my dad would work. Wednesday night through Saturday night was party time. So I remember being, you know, 3, 4, 5 year olds running around going crazy. And my parents were drinking and having a good time. But then on Sunday morning, we were in church. And but these folks kept talking to my parents, and my parents always would turn off the lights, like, we're not home kind of thing. And finally, one day, I asked my mom, like, so how did you guys become Christian? And she said, well, this couple just kept pounding on our door, just kept, you know, talking to us about, you know, the Lord. And finally, they said, you know what, we'll go to church with you. And they went to church. My dad got saved. My dad, to that point, he was a heavy drinker, smoker, and I mean, it was cold turkey. Just got saved, stopped smoking, stopped, you know, drinking, partying ended. You know, but that was one aspect of what happened in my household, was my parents getting saved and me being introduced to the Lord that way. I remember our new church was something that I actually absolutely loved, the church I grew up in. Canaan Baptist Church in New York. And so as a kid, I grew up with that upbringing. I had, you know, I was in church on Wednesdays, I was in church on Sundays, and, you know, I had that. Spiritual life was a big part of my life. And on the other end, though, my dad was a very angry person, totally angry person, you know, very bitter, you know, with his work life. And my mom was sickly, so she couldn't help out too much, so all the financial burden was on him. And, you know, because of that, he would get home really tired from work, doing overtime, that kind of thing. And his time with me wasn't exactly the type of environment that a kid at that age growing up would look for in dad. So, needless to say, years of that happened, and then by the time I was 17, 18 years old, I wanted nothing to do with, you know, being in church, being at home. I got a car. That was it. My independence happened. You know, I had my car. I was able to get at it whenever I wanted to, and, you know, because I was in his house, though, I had to go to church on Sunday. So as long as I live under his roof, you have to be in church on Sunday morning, even if I had just walked in a couple hours prior. So that went on for a couple of years, and my walk with the Lord was just, it was non-existent. And but throughout those couple of years that I had walked away, the Lord was always with me. There are things that happened in my life that I know I shouldn't be here. There's no reason why I should be here. Situations that I was in, people I was involved with, you know, friends or so-called friends at the time. So the Lord never left my side. Never, never. I mean, I can look back now and just, I can see his hand on me no matter what. You know, I was always blessed with, you know, a good job. I was blessed with certain people in my life that were actually beneficial for me. My parents, they were always there. My mom was constantly praying for me. So that was something that, I mean, to this day, I thank the Lord for a prayer warrior like my mom. You know, she just always on her knees, always, you know, in the Word, just constantly praying for us, for myself, my other brothers, and just never stopped, never, ever stopped. And to this day. And so that was something that I just saw evidence of that, you know, as I look back and I see my life and where I am now. And to the point where even where I was at a club one night, I met my wife, you know, at that time it was just another girl I was meeting. And, you know, God put her in my life, you know, and what's even crazier about it is that this is a woman who I met who up to that point had no religious background. Her mom, you know, was a, you know, French, who, you know, grew up Catholic but doesn't believe in anything, pretty much is agnostic. Her dad also grew up Catholic and just doesn't practice anything, but he's, you know, he calls himself a Catholic. And, but I brought her to my dad's church because, like I said, I had to be at church if I lived under his roof. So being a Spanish church, I had to translate the message to her, and that was kind of difficult, trying to listen and translate at the same time, because she didn't know much Spanish at the time. And at her, one of her jobs, while she was in college, she had a job as a paralegal. One of her coworkers invited her to a church, Baptist church down in Somerset. And we went. She invited her during the week. We went that Sunday. I said, you know what, I'm tired of translating for you, so we've got to go to an American church. So we go to the church, and it was life-changing. The Lord, like I said, had never left my side. And Pastor Miller is the pastor at Somerset Bible Baptist Church in Somerset. And I'll never forget it. That day, Jeremy, you know, gave her life to the Lord. She got saved during the altar call. And I just got on my knees and just asked the Lord to walk with me again, you know, just to allow me to walk with him, because I knew he was always with me. And I gave my life back to the Lord at that church. Jeremy got baptized at that church. We were married by Pastor Miller in 2001. And we've been together this month, it'll be 14 years. Mm-hmm. Just to look back and see that, you know, how God used, you know, even somewhere where I wasn't supposed to be, where I found my wife, you know, and everything that we've been through, you know, over the last almost 20 years, 14 years married, which is another part of my story where we've been through ups and downs, you know, and not because we've had a bad marriage, but because we wanted to have kids so bad. You know, since the moment we got married, we wanted to, you know, fill our house with kids. And that wasn't God's plan. So for the first couple of years, you know, we were just doing it the way normal couples do, right? Just, you know, oh, it'll happen, and whatever happens. After the first year, we're like, all right, it's not happening. And second year comes around, we're like, oh, wow, you know, maybe we should start looking into, you know, what the issue is. So Jen gets tested, I get tested. Turns out we both have issues. So we're like, all right, so it's not just one of us, it's the both of us. So we're, you know, we're in prayer, people at church are in prayer, you know, over our situation. And that was a true test in at that time. Personally, I mean, I was going through my battle, Jen was going through hers, and it was a very difficult time. Because you trust the Lord, and you know that it's in His hands. But at the same time, we're selfish and we want things the way we want them. We want, you know, we want things to work out the way we want them. We have our plans, and if they don't match God, sometimes we get mad at God. And I was trying my hardest not to. I know Jen was going through her battle, and one of the biggest things that came to mind, you know, through a song from Stephen Curtis Chapman, was just "Be Still." And that song broke me down one day. I was just driving, and I heard it on the radio, and just had to stop. I had to pull over. Just to be reminded that we need to just be still and just trust God. And just put it all in His hands. And that changed everything for us. At that point, I mean, it got us through it. You know, different things happened at the time where Jen got a different job. She ended up working at the children's clinic. And, you know, so we thought that was our plan. You know, we're going to go through that route, you know, the medical route. And then, but what was interesting about that was just to see the number of people that were going through what we were going through. And to see the number of people that were breaking up due to that situation. You know, just the number of marriages just breaking. You know, I guess there was no foundation in those relationships, and one thing that we could just look at each other and say, you know what, we don't have that part in our lives, but we have everything else, and we have the Lord. And that was that. Our foundation in the Lord is what has kept us together. It's kept us sane. Just has kept me from losing it, and my wife as well. And that's the, you know, the other thing is, you know, Josh just got married, you know, Julian just got married, and every couple that gets married, that's the first thing we tell them, is just the Lord in the center of your life. Mm-hmm. You know, just as long as you guys are both looking towards the Lord, that's it. You know, everything else is going to come, things are going to come, things are going to happen, but having the Lord in your life and following Jesus is the only way to get through anything, no matter how hard it may seem. So that's how I've gotten here. And One of the things that happened to us throughout this process of not being able to have children is my cousin had a conversation with us one day about just what she does for a living. She works for the state of New Jersey with the Division of Youth and Family Services. And she mentioned to us all these different cases of kids that are, you know, just looking for a home. And it was like answered prayer. It was answered prayer because we had been, you know, talking about it, praying about it. Like, what are we going to do? I guess, you know, probably adopt. And we signed up, like, the next day. We went online. We filled out the application. 6 months later, we got licensed to become foster parents. That was January 2013. That first week, we got a call for two little boys we took in. They stayed with us till May of that year. They left. And they went back to, they were reunified with their grandmother. And we actually had them here in church, and everybody got to meet them. And but them leaving, that was another test. Them leaving was, it was another loss. It was almost like losing a family member. You know, it was like a death in the family. It shook us. But again, you know, our faith in the Lord, just like, you know what? This is where we need to be. We're not going to quit. We're sticking with it. That September, we got a call for two boys that needed a home. And those are the two boys that we have with us now, 2 years later. And, you know, that situation is, we're at a point where we're going to be adopting them soon. That's in God's hands when it happens, but we know that it's going to happen. So, you know, we're blessed. We have two boys at home. Our family, we feel, is complete at this point. You know, if God brings more children into our home, I mean, that's up to God. But we never lost faith, and that's what I wanted to say. It's just we thank the Lord for what we have now, and we, you know, our family to continue.
Amen.